First, we have a worship team. Worship team to the front stage. Worship team to the stage. I need you, Lord. Once again, welcome everybody to Y Community Church. You're welcome to stand and worship with the worship team.
Thank you. Oh, them
hello,
again.
Hello. 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 There you go. Okay.
Thank you.
everybody.
Good morning.
It's nice to be with you again. It's been a while. I think I got a call from Pastor BJ around 4:30 in the afternoon to tell me that his grandson had a seizure, and they were at the hospital, and they were seeing that what was happening to him, and he said they found out that his grandson had COVID, and he was exposed to COVID. And that's why he said, I don't want you guys to be exposed to it. So he said, can you preach tomorrow? So I said, yes, reluctantly. Because you know that we had a really busy week last week. We just concluded VBS, and it just reminded me how old I've gotten, because it was very tired. And yesterday we were supposed to be, we went to my, before that, I had a busy week actually. My daughter's dog, Hallie, was 14 years old, and she had to put her down. And so it was a very sad day for her and our family, because we had that dog for such a long time. You know, the dogs become part of your family. And then yesterday after BBS, we were supposed to have a family gathering, because yesterday was my mom's birthday, and it was also the death of my father. We celebrated that together. My father died on my mother's birthday after she fed him breakfast, and then he just passed away. And it's been a long time. It was 1999 when he died. My mother died in 2002. So it's been a while, but we try to keep that together so that we as a family can be together. And I guess my daughter wasn't feeling it, so she didn't show up. But again, we were all so tired, so it was fine. Okay. Today's message, I titled this Keep Moving Forward, and I kind of dug this up from my archives, and I actually preached this in 2020, and this was the third week of the beginning of our shutdown when we had COVID. And I entitled it Keep Moving Forward. Do you remember the movie Meet the Robinsons? It's a Disney movie where a child actually became an inventor, and he was able to go back in time and found out what happened. So, but the idea is, you know, you don't let these bad things that happen to you, the difficulties, the trials, the barriers to our dreams, change you in a way. But I kind of related it to our growing up and maturing as Christians. Like I said, you know, it says trusting God even when times are difficult. And we have a lot of difficult times. I mean, it's not COVID anymore, but as you've noticed, our money has gotten down in value. You know, when you go to the grocery store, or even if you just go out to eat, I still remember when you could buy something like lunch for $3.50, and now we're up to about $12 for lunch, I think. You know, you go to the grocery store, you know, we go to Costco or Sam's, and we're always paying like $190 or almost $200. And it's not even, our basket isn't full, you know, anymore. And we go so often, you think that we, you know, we don't need to pay so much. But we started the virtual meeting back then. And like I said, it was our third week, and we started to do distancing, and we were wearing our masks, if you remember. And when you're in public, you're kind of afraid to be close to someone, because you're afraid that you might die, because we saw all of these things happening, you know. And I was listening back then to Alistair Vega. I don't know if you know him. He's on the radio. His ministry is called Truth for Life. He's one of my favorite people that I like to listen to. He said, to think about how we can handle a particular strain of anxiety that comes when we are waiting for a friend that is gliding towards us. It's visible above the, it's thin is visible above the surface. You know, as the COVID-19 coronavirus provides us with an opportunity to think about how we should respond to anxiety. And nowadays, let's look at how our economy is giving us anxiety and about the future and what it brings. You know, I'm at the age that I'm supposed to retire, and I was hesitant actually even to be a pastor because I thought if I become a pastor, I might not be able to support my lifestyle. And actually, before I gave in to being a pastor, my former pastor was telling me in 2008 that he wanted to ordain me when he found out I was going to school. But I just went to school so that I could just validate myself. But he had other intentions, and I kept on giving him every reason I could to say no to being a pastor. I said, "Pastor, when I finish paying off my house, I'll think about it. Pastor, after my kids graduated from school, my kids were all in college all at the same time, and we were paying for their education because we felt that, you know, my husband, my wife, and I, our parents paid for our education, so we were going to pay for our kids' education so that they wouldn't have any kind of debt. And so we were paying for that. I used that as an excuse to get away from being a pastor. But eventually, I ran out of excuses. And you know, God brought me to the point that, well, he created Crossroads for us to be in. So here we are. So let's look at where our text is. We're in Joshua 3. I wanted to share this with you because one of my favorite stories is about Joshua and how the Lord led them with Moses and then Joshua towards the promised land. And let's just stand up and let's read these first two verses. And you can read it with me. Right. Can you read it again? There. It says, "Early in the morning, Joshua and all the Israelites set out from Shittim and went to the Jordan, where they camped before crossing over. After 3 days, officers went around the camp." Praise God for the reading of this word. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, be with us today as we study your word. We pray, Lord, that the Holy Spirit gives us the inspiration. And also, we need to hear from you on a personal level. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It can be seen. So, with these verses, it's a little too easy to miss a little detail in these first two verses of Joshua chapter 3. And it's this: the people had to camp and wait at the river's edge for 3 days. So when they were staring at the river Jordan for 3 days, and the river actually, without knowing what was coming next and how they would cross, you know. And the river at that time was what they thought was swollen because it was at a flood stage, whipping by with its strong current. I don't know if you've been following the news. The Philippines right now just went through a very wet tropical storm named Karina. And it has actually flooded the cities of Manila, the surrounding cities, even up to the suburbs where cars were floating by, the rivers were raging. And I saw the river here in California when I first came here. I was surprised that the bottom of the LA River is concrete. Did you know that?
Amen.
So, yeah, that's kind of different. Because in the Philippines, our rivers are really just where water runs. And when there's a storm, especially with Karina like that, the water just kind of like surges and then it even comes out of the banks And we have a property there that I had inherited from my great aunt. And I had them build a block wall to stop the water from eroding the land that we have there. And you know that before this last one, we had two walls of concrete that were washed out by the river just because of the strength of the flow that it comes. And if you can imagine yourself, if you're an Israelite and you want to cross the river, and you're thinking God wants us to cross the river, and you're looking at this dark water, you know, muddy water, flowing by with such a speed, and you're probably going to ask, well, how are we going to somehow cross this dark river with flood-stirred sediment? Now, what's it going to be? Because you can imagine they also had their sheep, their livestock, their children, their precious heirlooms, all of the things that they had, because they, remember, they were still walking away from Egypt into the promised land that God told them to where they were supposed to go. You know, the question is, how does it feel to know that God is calling you to keep moving forward, that He's promising to be with you, but that all you can actually see is a river whose depth you do not know, but whose fatal power you can be sure of? You know, they say that fear makes cowards of us all. You know, a lot of us, or all of us, have the fear of the unknown. Especially now, I mean, being growing old, before BBS started, I threw out my back just putting on my shoes. Can you imagine that? I bent forward to tie my shoe, and I couldn't straighten up my back anymore. And every step I made, I was making a sound, oh. And I was going to speak that Sunday on July 14th. And my wife said, I don't think we could make it today. I said, well, we can. I'll make it today. And praise God that we were able to make it. And then I spoke. And I felt better, actually, on Monday. So I started working again. By the end of the evening, I took a shower, went to bed. And by 11 o'clock, I had really sharp pain throughout the whole week. And I thought I wasn't going to be able to walk or do anything. But again, BBS started, and I was able to walk, and I was, just taking it easy. And when you have pain like that, you're kind of afraid to do many things, which we committed to being at the BBS. But I'm sure they'll excuse us for if we don't come. But the thing is, how does that become a reflection of us trusting in the Lord and what He has called us to do? You know, we have, even today, we have an economy that is inflated. The value of our money has gone down. The world is restless, and we have rumors of war. You know that there's a lot of battleships in the Pacific right now, and I'm just thinking they're just waiting for something to just screw up, and that's gonna start the whole thing, because China is on this path where they feel that they have to take the region's resources for themselves, because their country is not doing too well. So we don't know. And today, did you know that our country owes $338 trillion? Did you know that? That's how much we owe. And I heard on the news one night that we're not going to be able to pay for that. So what's going to happen? for the future of our kids. What's going to happen when our country continues to responsibly handle the money that they have? We've been giving away millions of dollars to support wars somewhere else. We've been giving it away to people that don't belong in this country. And we're feeling the heat ourselves. And that's making us not think of being a Christian or, you know, loving and sharing. Because again, it comes to the point where we're afraid. We don't know what's going to happen. Well, God is continuing to call us forward in love of neighbor and service to his kingdom. And it's hard when all we can see is the possibility of not a good future for us. You know, I remember when somebody sneezed during COVID, we were guarded already. You know, we didn't want to be around people. You know, so it kind of makes you think, if God wanted these people to go across the river, why didn't he just, like, lift them up and put them across to safely cross, right? Or, you know, or he could have done something miraculously. He could have, but he didn't.
Amen.
You know, he didn't ask him to swim and float across, seeing to it that everybody made it safely, every sheep and gold earring was accounted for. You know, he could have done things like that. Instead, God chose for his people to wait and watch the flood, inviting them to trust him with all that crossing that flood might mean. You know, God is telling us to do something despite the barriers, the hindrance, the resistance of us being able to do it. And that, you know, like I said, that goes to the part of who we know our God is. And if we don't know who God is, then we can't trust him. So, like I said, in verse 15, it says, now the Jordan is at flood stage all during harvest. And Joshua gives orders to the people. He says in verse 3, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the Levitical priest carrying it, you are to move out from your positions and follow it. Then you will know which way to go, since you have never been this way before. But keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits between you and the Ark. Do not go near it. And then verse 5 says, Joshua told the people, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. So go back to verse 3. God wants us to focus on who he is and focus on it. Remember, I think it's in, is it Hebrews, that looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. He's telling the people here to look at the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. What is the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord? The Ark of the Covenant of the Lord has the mercy seat where God sits on his throne. So basically, it's an icon of the presence of God among his people. And then they said, you should move up from your positions and follow it. So he's saying, follow me where I'm going to go. Since you do not know the way to go, because you have never been this way before. I think we've all been in that position where we've experienced something that came into our life and we have no idea on how to handle That's the church.
Amen.
It just overcomes us because we have no way of handling it. I remember when my mom came back here to the States. She was about to die, 6 months before she was going to die. We had begged her to come here because she lost her vision. She was living by herself. And then we found out she had an nasopharyngeal cancer, which was a cancer inside her brain, which went through her nose. And the cancer was wrapped around the main artery of her brain, which really made it not a possibility of having surgery. And mind you, there are six of us, her kids, that live here. I am the youngest, and I have three sisters and two brothers. But it's amazing that although we love our home, not all of us committed to taking care of it. So I was in a situation where I had my mother in my home. My kids were 12, 10, and 8, so they were very young. I was working a job, my wife was working a job. My mother was at home, she needed a caregiver. We got two caregivers, but that was still not enough. And we needed help, even just relief on a weekend. And not all of my siblings volunteered to do it. It became such an irritation against us that we began scratching at one another, that we started arguing and then pointing fingers and, you know, how bringing up things in the past that happened that you didn't ever have thought was a problem. And we didn't know how to address that because we never had to go through. I never thought that my family would have such an argument about just loving and taking care of one another. We came to the point where I told my wife, because my wife was, I didn't know, this is how stupid that is, because my wife actually was defending me against my brothers and sisters. But it came out to me where I thought she was against me, because I felt like I put her in a situation where she had to carry a lot of the burden when I had siblings that couldn't help. And my resolution to that, when I told her, I said, you know what, why don't I take my mom, I'll get an apartment, and we'll live there, and you and the kids can stay at home. And that was not taken well by my wife. She said, you're abandoning me? You know, and she said something very hurtful. She said, now I recognize that the husband will throw away a wife just to take care of his mother. And we almost separated just because of that. Like I said, you know, I thank God, God gave me wisdom to answer that. I just told her, you know, I want us to be together, but I don't know if this is gonna work this way, but I want you to be by my side. And after I told her that, she completely zipped up her lip and did not say anything, which did not, it kind of de-escalated the situation. So again, there are instances in our lives where we go through experiences where we don't know what we're going to do because we have never been there before. But amen. God said that, you know, just look to where I am. Follow me, and I will show you where to go. Just keep a distance of about 2,000 cubits. A cubit is like 3 feet. So about 6,000 feet. So you can still see where the ark is between you and the ark. Because he said, don't go near. Remember when David's men, they wanted to carry the ark, they weren't supposed to go near, and they touched and they died immediately. So God was giving them this kind of precaution. Just don't go near it, you know. And then the people followed. And Joshua told them, consecrate yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do amazing things among you. You know, sometimes we don't understand the word consecrate. Consecrate yourselves or sanctify yourselves. Joshua's telling, this is a spiritual battle. Joshua requires that the people have a spiritual preparation. You know, what are we doing spiritually so that we can stand up against these things that are set up in front of us to make us fail? You know, the Bible tells us to meditate on God's word. The Bible tells us to pray. The Bible tells us to come to the Lord. You know, we have to spiritually prepare ourselves so that before that time comes when we move forward into the position where God tells us to go, we made an intentional preparation and renewed our minds, you know, so that we cannot be conformed to this world, but be transformed in the renewing of our minds. You know? Joshua understood that the problem was not only physical, but spiritual. So we need to prepare ourselves spiritually. We have to dedicate ourselves to God. It's not bad to listen to the news and look at what's happening in the world, but don't stop washing your hands or putting a face mask or avoiding being in a complete proximity to someone you do not know. The Bible does not tell us to let go of practicality. Again, this is during COVID. But it calls us to seek God. Believe in Him. That is why all of our message prior to this one is, and always is, to build up. We need salvation from God and realizing that Jesus was the payment for our sins. We need to understand what faith does and how it is our vehicle to touch God and be pleasing to Him. We need to focus on God. The Bible tells us about eternal life. It tells us what God has prepared for us when we meet Him face to face. But we should know that eternal life is not just a benefit. Now, eternal life is not just a sweet by and by. You know? When we die, we go to the sweet by and by. No, eternal life, in John 17, verse 3 says, now this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. You know, we have a benefit of eternal life, even as we are here on earth, because eternal life brings us a knowledge of who God is. And that's why the Bible keeps on telling us, trust in the Lord and not lean not unto your own understanding. In all your ways, He says, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. And that's why every day we gotta show up with God. We gotta show up and walk with God so that we can know Him and that we can truly say that I know what eternal life is all about. So let's go to know Jesus here and now as He shows us the wonders He will do among us in this situation. By the way, it says sanctify yourselves. He says means they were to separate themselves from common things to focus in on the Lord and to see that the Lord will do wonders among you. Now, it was in the 90s that I started trying to learn how to use the computer. And my motivation to learn how to use the computer was not for myself. I realized that kids were being given homework now on the computer. And in the 90s, we did not have a single computer at home. And I said, if my kids start getting these homeworks, I will not be able to help them. The first thing I learned on the computer is G-I-G-O. You know what G-I-G-O means? Garbage in, garbage out.
Amen.
Garbage in, garbage out. Whatever you put in the computer, that's what you're going to get out. So let's say you just borrow a friend's computer, and when you go to the internet, all the things that come out are pornographic. You can tell your friend is putting in garbage. And that's why garbage is going out. So, what did they do? How did they get to know Jesus or God? Well, Joshua said to the Israelites, come here and listen to the words of the Lord your God. First and foremost, we have to come and we have to listen. That's where showing up is. You know, I was surprised in elementary that I kept passing every grade and I wasn't studying. And I realized I passed every grade because I kept showing up. And I still learned something, even though I wasn't investing myself in it. But the Bible says, come. The Bible says, draw near to him, and he shall draw near to you. That's in James 4:8. Jeremiah 29 says, then you will call upon me, and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you. Isn't that such a reassuring? That God said, you're going to come to me. I'm going to listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. I will be found by you, says the Lord. And I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord. I will bring you to the place from which I caused you to be carried away captive. What's he saying? I'm going to free you from everything that makes you not be able to think or even do what you think you're supposed to do. And the promises that I have given you. Why do you sometimes think that, I'm going to work, but nothing's happening? Well, that's because our mind is still captive by the hindrances that we are being fed when we don't come to God. That's why we have to come and listen. You know, faith comes by hearing, and hearing through the Word of God. You know, if you keep on listening to the news, all you're going to be doing is getting worried. Right?
Amen.
Turn on your TV. I mean, even the cost of cars. Who can buy a car now? And they want you to buy an EV. When the battery breaks down, it's more expensive than the car. Right? He said, listen. To listen is to take heed. It means to carefully pay attention to the words of God. See, the more you listen to God and his promises, the more you will know what kind of involvement God has in your life. Did you know that? That God is involved in every aspect of your life? That he sees us growing old and slow and we're weak? And he's going to take care of us still. Because his involvement is very detailed. Just as detailed as his plan of our salvation. You know. If you listen and pay attention close enough, you will see what God provides for you. And some of us will say, hey, Pastor, but I'm so old now. You know, I'm really poor. I can't do anything. I lost my job. I don't have an income. I cannot go out and make a living anymore. I'm too old. If you woke up this morning and you took a shower with hot water, I would say you are not poor. Did you know there's a lot of people in other countries who take showers in regular temperature water, even cold water, because they're so poor, they don't even have the instrumentation or the means to heat up their water, or even have water to take a bath. You're relatively better off than most of the world, where people will never ever get the experience taking a shower with warm water. You know, I heard one time a person from Africa said that you people in America are rich. You all have two homes, one for yourself and one for your car.
Amen.
Can you imagine that? We have better looking garages than homes in other countries. I stood up and spoke at a church in the middle of a rice field, and they just had palm fronds as walls, and I sat underneath a 12-inch fluorescent bulb at night. And they were so poor, they came down from the mountains and walked through the rice fields. No. Again, you're not poor, and you're richer than the rest of the world. Sometimes it's just a matter of perspective. Some people regard spam as special food, right? You know, a lot of us here in the States, we hate spam. Yeah? And we call it something posing as meat, spam. Something posing as meat. But did you know? If you ate spam to the Philippines, man, you got a good breakfast. Well, you just go to Hawaii. You get wasabi. And that's because people in the Philippines, people in Hawaii, we got used to the rations of the military. Or that's where we get our meat from. You know, not Seder Brothers. We get our meat from the army. People will be envious of you if you had spam and eggs for breakfast. Verse 11 reminds us that as he talked to Joshua, that even when we walk into the floodwaters to cross the violent stream, even if you do not have a life preserver, God will not let you down. In Joshua 1, he said, no, in verse 5, he said, no one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their ancestors to give them. That sounds like a promise to me, doesn't it? You know? And he tells us, I'm going to be with you. In fact, in some verses in the Bible, God said, I'm going to be there ahead of you. I'm going to prepare this place for you so that when you get there, everything's going to be fine. I used to have this patient, old cholo. He kept on saying, everything's copacetic and angiogenic. So, I guess you guys don't get that, but that's what he always said. I kind of thought that was cute. Everything's copacetic on the jetty. Isaiah 43, you're not tired of it. I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they won't overflow you. You will walk through the fire and you will not be burned, neither shall a flame kindle upon you. Why? Because he is who he said he is. He said, "For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee." So let's go to verse 12. "Now then, choose 12 men, tribes of Israel, and soon as the priest who carried the ark of the Lord of all the earth, set foot in the Jordan, its waters flowing downstream will be cut off and stand up in the heat." So when the people broke camp to cross the Jordan, the priest carrying the ark of the covenant went ahead of them. Okay. So they were given this instruction. So verse 15, "Now the Lord, the flood, Jordan is at flood stage all during harvest. Yet, as soon as the priests who carried the ark reached the Jordan, and their feet touched the water's edge," what happened? Verse 16, "the water from the upstream stopped flowing. It piled up in a heap a great distance away at a town called Adam in the vicinity of Zarethan. While the water flowing to the sea of the Arabah, that is the Dead Sea, was completely cut off, so the people crossed over opposite Jordan." And then verse 17, "The priest who carried the ark of the covenant of the Lord stopped in the middle of the Jordan and stood on dry ground while all Israel passed by until the whole nation had completed the crossing on dry ground." At the beginning of their attempt, there was a menacing river telling them they cannot cross. But when they focus on God and what God told them to do, and that he would be with them as they did such a thing, and they trusted him, nothing happened yet until they started moving forward and obeying God. You know what the problem with us is? We wait till we see evidence before we follow God. Is that not true?
Amen.
Yeah. We play it safe. I'm gonna wait. No. But God calls us to do things, and he wants us to obey despite no evidence seen yet. But once they started moving forward, everything dried up. As you can see, they did not walk on a moist ground. They did not walk on a wet sand or mud. They crossed on dry ground. And even while the priests that were carrying the ark were there, you know, people were crossing. Everything stopped. And God is not just the God of his people. God is the God that created the world. And he's the same God that tells the wind to blow, the waves to crash, the storm to come or to stop. No. God has that capability. And he has the capability of taking us through difficult situations in our lives where we do not have control of what's happening to us, where we think we're defeated and now we're just victims of it. No, God has the ability to see us through. Again, trusting, following, obeying, looking, listening, coming. So, what did he say in verse chapter 4? Well, he told the guys, "Well, while the guys are there, each one of you from each tribe get a stone And we're going to put it on the other side as a memorial. We're running out of time, so I'm just kind of doing that. So he said, well, you're going to make a memorial so that you can remember what God did for you. So God's telling us, remember. And you know what? Another thing that's wrong with us, we forget what God has done for us in the past as we now encounter another problem, right? It's like a friend of mine, he got laid off from Spectrum a long time ago, and he was one of the deacons, and he was like, oh, I'm not going to have a job, and won't be able to do this, and won't be able. And then, you know, he was off the work for about 3 or 4 months, and God had to go through. And we had members of our church who had kids in college, and then the one spouse lost their job. And they said, how are we going to do this? How are we going to pay for the tuition fee? And they found out it was better if they were laid off during the time that their kids were in college, because the kid, because of the decreased income, qualified for a grant. They said, well, that paid for my daughter's tuition, even though I got laid off. Yeah. And then this guy, like I said, that he was a deacon in our church, he got laid off again, and he didn't remember how God let him go through not having a job in the past. I'm asking you, brothers and sisters, what has God done for you in the past that you should make a memorial for, so that when this thing comes again, you will remember God's faithfulness in your life?
Amen.
Like he said, I will never leave you, and I will never forsake you. My wife and I was able to overcome, you know, this family problem we had. We were taking care of my mother. My mother passed away. We took care of her. It was just a 6-month period in our life. And it felt like it was 3 years. Because of just the arguing, just the finger pointing. But praise the Lord, God is with us. He let us go through in a situation that we never experienced before. And now if I go through that again, I know what to do. I know who I can trust. I know who will see me through. I know that everything will be okay, because who holds my tomorrow? It's God who holds my tomorrow.
Amen.
I can't depend on our government.
Amen.
Can't depend on Dennis giving me money and allowance.
Amen.
He might for a little while, but he'll probably give up on me as well. But that's the thing. We have to keep moving forward and trusting God and believing who he is and believing that his promises are real and that he'll stand by them and that he will make it happen despite what we're going through. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So, let's just do a conclusion of this now. Well, what we've learned, keep moving forward. Well, first we have to come and listen. We saw that in verse 3, 9, 1, 8. We need to be filled with the word of God, not garbage. Transforming words that changes our hearts, that changes our hearts of stone into a heart of flesh, that makes his word written in our hearts and in our minds. So come, listen, and expect change. And then, once we're doing that, we should prepare ourselves, consecrate, make yourself intentionally. Prepare yourself and separate yourself for God. Then we should move forward, based on your trust in His promise. That's why we call it a walk with God. You know, we keep walking with God, we keep walking closer and closer to Him, and then we can trust that He will see us through in any situation. Then, always remember, He is always with us and ahead of us. Verse 11, 1 to 5 again, and we should trust in Him. Remember where your true safety is, the life, and the last is, remember what He has done. It says in Isaiah 45:2, I will go before you and make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. God will make your path straight. Deuteronomy 31:8 says, the Lord Himself goes before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. So don't be afraid. Do not be discouraged. I hope this has been an encouragement to you. I mean, it's difficult times. We must admit that. But we have a great God. We have a God we can trust. We have a God whose concerns is for the things that concern us. And He, as He says, He will always be there. So, my advice, keep showing up. Let's conclude with God's benediction. Now unto Him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless into His presence with thanksgiving, to the only one God, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, and the people of God said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Thank you very much, Pastor Jun, for helping us out the last moment's notice. We're going to do the closing song.
We ask that you bless this church, bless the people that are in here.